Hey, what's up, everybody? Welcome to DI Radio, the show where I interview some of the most influential people in the Smash community. I'm Vance. This is Izaw. Hey, Izaw, how are you doing?
Hey, man, how you doing? I'm good. How about you?
I'm doing pretty good today. It is currently, as of the recording, I'm trying to find my phone here. It is currently about to be 11:30 here in West Coast time. I know you were telling me earlier it's like 8 o'clock over there.
Yeah, 8:30 almost.
So yeah, where are you actually? I don't even know where you are.
I'm in southern Sweden at the moment.
Okay, cool. Are you currently
something called Malmö?
Okay.
Sorry, say that again.
Are you currently living there, or you're just working there?
Yeah.
Okay, nice.
Yeah.
Nice.
I was going to live in the U.S., but 2020 changed my mind pretty hard.
I was going to live in Japan and Korea for like at least a month, and yeah, 2020 changed a lot. So
yeah,
I know a lot of people are probably wondering, like, yeah, 2020 changed the world. For sure.
Right.
That's very, very true. So, Izaw, I know who you are. You're one of my favorite content creators. But for those who don't know who you are, what's your elevator pitch?
Well, I'd say I'm probably one of the top Smash YouTubers, at least, in terms of educational content and artistic content, maybe, because I try to keep it artistic or thematic. And if you want to like learn how to play the game or learn how to play a certain character, then that's basically what I do best. Other than that, I coach people almost every single day, 6 hours per day. I travel, go to tournaments. Not a lot of people know that, but I'm one of the only Europeans that constantly travels to the US and all over Europe and just goes to tournaments. And yeah.
Yeah, that was something I kind of noticed. Well, just to backtrack a little bit, like when the PGR got released, a lot of people were, myself included, complaining like, hey, there's a lot of European tournaments that weren't really included here. And it also, it also feels like, you know, I tell people, like, I felt like Space should have been included. I felt like Quick should have been included. And these players were just kind of like left out a little bit. And then a lot of European tournaments that happened just made me feel like, wow, you guys, I thought with including more of Japan, we would also include more of Europe, which is a region that I've always heard a lot about. But yeah, that's great. I think that's one thing that we talked about earlier a little bit in the pre-show, where I talked about how content creation is really important when it comes to the Smash community. And yeah, you're one of the best when it comes to the educational thing. And to me, in terms of my knowledge, you know, I'm sorry if I haven't found your channel, a random person out there, but like, to me, there's only one person who does it really, really well to your standard. That it becomes a video like, oh, I have to watch this video. Because even if I already know the character, there may be one or two things I don't know. And I feel like I learn more even if I already know something. And it becomes this video of, hey, like I told you, 30 minutes. In 30 minutes, you can learn this character. And if you already learned it, you can come back to this video as a reference book and learn even more.
Right. And the thing is, each scene and each little moment is very carefully recorded so that each little interaction is shown off very carefully and very like intricate at top level two, and only top level players will catch it. Beginners won't catch it. They'll just see like the general gist of what happens on screen, but then like once they become better after 3 weeks with the character or at the game, they come back and rewatch it and they see new things, even though they've rewatched it. Same thing, they come back after 3 months after they're kind of like gotten high level or top level, and then they learn even more small little details that they're just like, oh, I've seen this, but now I kind of understand exactly what's happening. And yeah, it's not totally intentional, but it kind of just happens to be that way, or it turned out to kind of just become that way.
It worked well for me when we talk about Smash 4. Like, I told everybody, how did I learn the characters aside from watching VODs, looking at my own playstyle, looking at other players' playstyle, talking to, you know, some of the players in my scene, like Larry, Nico, AC, just to name a few. Talking to them was really helpful. But also, like, I just told everybody, like, there was one content creator that kind of stood up to me personally, that stood above the rest. And am I pronouncing it right for the record, actually? Is it Izaw or Izaw?
You can say whatever you want. I personally say Izaw. Okay. A lot of people say Izaw. Right. But, like, it doesn't matter.
Just so I can get it out right off the back. It's going to bug
you. Yeah, no, it doesn't matter.
So, yeah, it was Izaw who, like, when I looked at your Smash 4 videos, right, that was really influential for me as somebody who wanted to learn commentary. because I started to learn the nicher things that some people didn't know when it came to Marth Nair 1. I just didn't know that that could work. I didn't know right. that you can stall at the height of your jump with Marth's side special. I didn't know that. So there were some right. things that, like, I started to learn that were niche. People go like, oh, wow, Vance, you learned that. I was like, granted, I'm saying this on the mic. I'm learning it from somebody who said this 3-4 months ago. Right. and I tell people like it's okay. Content is everybody has their own version of what they want to watch when it comes to content. Somebody, you know, wants to turn their brain off and they want to watch a funny video.
Right.
And I felt like Alpha Red does that really, really well when it comes to Smash content. But for me,
yeah.
I try to see the educational value in content so that I'm always taking something with me. And right. then when it came on my suggestion feed, this guy named Izaw Smash, I was like, hey, who is this guy? Let me watch his videos. Oh, he's got a backlog. Oh, I suck at this game. Oh, he tells me how to start from beginner, intermediate to like master and thought process. And then just became like, I felt like I'm going to school.
Right.
Yeah. That's what it was. And it felt great. It felt great. Like I felt like I was learning something. So something I want to ask you is where did you start with this? What was your thought process beginning this? Because that's what my curiosity is. Like I said, you know, there's a lot of content creators out there, but not many who do the educational content. We talked about it in pre-show, right? There was Youngtown who did Smash Academy, which I was very excited for, and then that I don't know what happened. He just disappeared. I never followed him on
right.
Twitter. So that was the thing. And then there's Youngtown, Beefy Smash Dudes does it a little bit. You know, if you're into the patch notes. I think they have the best video for that in terms of the patch notes.
Yeah.
And then I always tell people, like, I think Izaw is the number one to just, if you want to learn a character, if you want to start off the game, this is the channel you should go to. So what was the beginning for you? What was your thought process?
Honestly, it just kind of, like, snowballed randomly. I didn't really plan any of this. The only thing that I remember, if I want to go back, like, all the way, was that, like, 10 to 12 years ago, I watched this, like, Link guide by Germ. For Melee.
Yeah.
I don't know if you remember that, but it was like a shit show of a video. Yeah. But I was like, oh, cool. Like, I can learn things from a video because now we can record Melee and put it on the computer and edit it, which was new at the time. So I was like, cool, I want to try something like this. And then Brawl came out. And I just kind of like did my own thing where I was labbing Link and I discovered like 2 to 3 new things that I never saw anyone do. Mostly because you couldn't really, nobody was like, on the internet with footage yet. So I was like, all right, I'm gonna put something out there. And I put out some like advanced tech and just some cool combo video stuff and the Art of Link for Brawl and then Link again and a combo video. And I was like, cool. So a lot of people love this. They loved learning from this and a lot of people asked for more. So I just kind of like from there on started producing just like best of fives and best of sevens and just kind of like hype games. And when Smash 4 came out, I kind of just wanted to give that a second try. So I did like a pretty crusty and bad Sheik guide that I later updated like over time to a new Art of Sheik. Because at the time, I just kind of like did whatever I wanted to do. I was just, oh, there's a new tech. Let's just include the tech. And then I kind of did right. tech videos. And then one day I did the Art of Ike with Ryo. And he taught me how to play Ike, which was like a fundamental based character, which I didn't really, really know. What that fully was, but like investing myself into that made me realize, oh, this is how I play the game. This is how I shield pressure. This is how I catch landings. This is what I do after a combo. Like all these concepts of like corner pressure and whatever kind of like just came together. And so I was like, all right, so I should do this for Link and I should do this for this character and that character and whatever character people want. And just it kind of rolled after that. And eventually as people started asking me for like an hour session and now it's just like a normal daily thing that I do and had done for like 4 years almost.
Yeah.
Which is nuts.
I was going to say, that's incredible. I think that's something like to do something so well, in my opinion, so well for 4 years is pretty impressive.
Thank you.
For me, that was funny because that's how I started to learn a little bit more about, I wouldn't necessarily say play style, but I started to learn more about the ins and outs of the game coincidentally through that Ike video. Like there was a lot of terminology
right.
that you used that I was just like, I don't know what this is, but I need to look at what this is. I need to watch this video 5 times until I get it if I have to do that.
Right. That one was my breakthrough video in my own head. Like I was just like, holy shit, I can do so much now after realizing all of these things. I don't have to just fish for techs from characters anymore.
That's the funniest thing I tell people. When for me, when I ever learn a game, any fighting game, I have to learn tech skill before I learn a neutral, because sometimes I feel like I'm just boxing and I don't know anything else but to do than to just try to hit you with something that's a low frame and then hopefully I catch you off guard.
Right.
But yeah, that was actually one of my favorite ones, was the Rio video. How do you, what's your thought process about getting some of these players, where like, how do you, I reached out to you, you replied to me, you know, we exchanged a few information, right? And I was like, oh cool, I'm getting Izaw on the show, this is great. But how did it go for you? Because I know you've reached some of the bigger MO people, you know, some of the bigger top level players. How does that
right it's for some reason it's very easy. It's not very easy just to talk to me. I'm very open with everyone and anyone really who contacts me and who wants to talk to me about anything. But I kind of just ask them and they're like, hey man, love your stuff, sure, let's do it. Right. And I'm like, all right, let's go, let's do it. When can we like hit, like just hang out and you can teach me something, or like we can talk about it. And like, for example, right now I'm doing Art of Falcon of a Fatality, and I just hit up I was just like on his stream one day and I was like, hey, so maybe it's a good time for Art of Falcon. Someone said that, some random dude on his Twitch chat, and then Fatality was like, yeah, that would be great. Izaw, you down for that? And I was like, yeah, sure. And he's like, all right, so we'll call each other next week. And then we just started rolling.
Yeah. I'm not down for that. I'm sorry, I hate Falcon. That's what I have to tell people. Like, I hate this character from like maybe Melee, I was okay with him. I think I hated him the most in 4. I hated getting dash grabbed, and it was always my fault.
Right.
But going, do you have like a list of like, hey, I want to put out this character first or that character? Or do you just go like, hey, you know what? There are names on a dartboard. I'm throwing it and I'm doing Art of Falcon next. Or I'm doing, like you said, right? Like you just reached out to each other via Twitch chat and you guys said, let's do Art of Falcon. Or is there like names on a board? You threw your dart and like, oh, hey, look, I'm doing Cloud today, right? With Luna and a couple other players.
Right. Well, it's different because in Smash 4 it was pretty random. I just kind of did the characters I wanted to do, and then I was like, all right, so what do people want? And then should I just kind of surprise them? Should I take donations for it? Like, should I? It was kind of random. But in Smash Ultimate, when that came out, I used Smash 4 as like a reference for how I should build up the Ultimate like videos and characters. So what I did was, all right, for me, Ike was the best one to teach people how to play the game. So I started off with the Art of Ike for Ultimate. And then I did Mario because he's the fighting character instead of the sword character that is really good at teaching the game. And then I included Link because without the bomb, Link is like the simplest fighter slash sword slash projectile zoner.
Right.
And then the bomb was like a separate kind of video to it. And then I started going for Lucina because Lucina is basically also on like the same level of Ike, very easy to teach, very easy to learn, good character to like get better at. So I was like, all right, let's produce these first. And then I started going more into who else is simple, plus who else can I teach, plus who else am I fairly confident play style wise won't change and is like makes sense design wise. So like Yoshi, Wolf, like these characters are getting buffs and nerfs, but it's not changing their playstyle. It's only like elevating strength or lower, like decreasing strength or kill power or whatever. But it's the same combo, same like playstyle. And so I'm like, all right, let's just kind of get these characters out of the way. Now, Falcon seems fixed, and I don't think there's anything else that they would add to change up his playstyle. It seems fairly like, all right, this is what they wanted, and this seems like a good point for Falcon. So now I'm like, all right, Falcon is going to be one of them. ZSS is going to be one of them. Her playstyle seems to not be something they want to change. Kirby, and so it's now it's also like who is getting hyped up because of the buffs, and not just because oh they're stronger now, but oh they're kind of fixed and they feel more complete.
That's what I kind of had to tell everybody about the buffs when I first saw them on the patch notes. I told people, I don't think this is going to, none of these buffs change playstyle. What they do is they just add something to the character that the character was either, in my opinion, was either slightly weaker in this area or they wanted to add another layer in their playstyle. In terms of layer, I'm talking about like, oh, instead of you having to wait 10 more percent for you to kill, now you only have to wait 10% less. So you're effective, like Ike dash attack. Ike Aether, you know, things like that. That's what I told everybody.
60% on Ike Aether, though.
Which is insane to me, but that's what I tell people. I think when you look at the fundamental of the character, you can see that Ike has a lot, is very strong in fundamentals. If you know how right. to do things like dash grab, if you know how to, not so much dash grab, but if you know how to
spacing, like shield pressure, understanding defense, and mm-hmm. yeah.
then this character will fit to you and will play just like MKLeo played him, like when the game launched mm-hmm. and everybody was saying Ike is broken. It's like, no, it's not that Ike is broken. It's that I know the fundamentals of the game that translates so well to this character
right.
that when this character is in my hands, this character is broken to you guys.
I think there's a reason why MKLeo picked Ike, and I think there's a reason why MKLeo is the best player at the moment, is because he actually started off with the characters like Ike and then Lucina and then Wolf, which are like at least one of the top four characters for me that are like the best to teach the game.
Yeah.
Understanding shield pressure, approaching, edge guard, like all of these little small things that are different from Smash 4, how to anti-air in this game much more so than how in Smash. The biggest change between Smash 4 and Ultimate that a lot of any high level to top level players missed is that there's a lot less focus on shield dashing mm-hmm. and a lot more focus on anti-airing. And you kind of only really, really see that by playing these simple characters. Otherwise, you're just focusing on like character-specific tech and like, oh, how can I combo with this character now? Small stuff like that. But yeah, I think he kind of just took off on the right track more than anyone else.
And I agree with you 110%. I actually tell everybody, I think the player that demonstrated that to me in his Wolf play was probably Charlie. Charlie was the one player mm-hmm. that I kind of saw like, oh, he knows how to anti-air. Like, he knows yeah. how to, he not only does he know how to anti-air, he knows how to fish for a combo, not fish for a combo, but get a combo that you yeah. don't know about that's super specific mm-hmm. to land it on you. And that's always been Charlie's playstyle, right? Like, he goes for the super niche combos that you don't see a lot of people do. He'll land them mm-hmm. on you, and then you get hit, and you're like, oh, I couldn't DI that. I was like, of course you couldn't, because the only person who knew that combo was Charlie. And right. I won't be mentioning him because, yeah, spoilers, I guess. Yeah, I'm going to get him on the show. Don't worry, guys.
Right, right. He's a good fundamental player.
And that's one thing that I tell people. I think fundamentals is people complain about this game like, oh, it's mashy, it's this, this and that. And I was like, if you have strong fundamentals, in from what I've seen in some players, you right. tend to supersede that mashy playstyle.
I love mashy playstyles because I destroy them more than anything else. And typically 95% of all of my like sessions, even if it's high or top level players, whenever I hit them upwards and juggle them, I always take advantage of them mashing. Like, they press attack, fast fall, and they're trying to trade. And yeah. I'm just like, I have a sword. So, like, for me, I'm good. I'll just do more up airs and I'll kill you even earlier. And, like, it's yeah, mashing just doesn't work against anyone who just knows how to play slow and calculated. Because each thing of mine will hit, and you're going to miss, like, 8 out of 10 things. That's, like, 8 openings for me, basically.
That's actually a very good thought process. That sometimes I try to tell people, like, when you're up in the air and you're getting juggled, I see sometimes people make the mistake of, I want to come back in with a forward air and hit you and then combo off.
Right.
And I was like, you can't do that. Like, you have yeah. to either think about resetting at the ledge or trying to time your air dodge so when your opponent does go for an air, you're able to get away and land safely.
Right, right.
But a lot of people, you know, I get it. I've always wanted to be yeah. someone who gets that comeback and everybody pops off for me.
Yeah.
But when it comes down to content creation, like going back to that circle here, when mm-hmm. it comes down to content creation, how have you taken it? Because, you know, that's the funniest thing I always see on Twitter was Izaw makes X video, and now we get to see X scrubby players go for that character.
On For Glory.
On For Glory or Elite Smash. And that's the one thing I tell people. It's like, I'm excited. Granted, I hate Falcon, but I'm excited to see right. your video. So maybe there's something that I learn.
Oh, you'll learn.
Yeah,
I'll learn how to beat him.
Exactly. That's what I'm yeah, looking forward yeah. to. Is not people being scrubby on Elite Smash or For Glory, but what is Izaw going to teach me to learn how to fight this character better? So how does right. he have to go through that? Right, that whole process.
It's fun. That's what I kind of. It's just a hobby of mine that turns into work. Mm-hmm. So most of my time, I just kind of like. I just do what I would do normally and just upload it, and it's being received so well. I think, like, I look at my channel comments a lot of the times, and I feel like there's maybe, like, 0.0.1 negative comments. Mm-hmm. Like, no one really, there's no negative shit in there. It's just people that are like, oh, great stuff, man, or like, hey, please do this, or whatever. So, like, yeah, it's just I'm in this like really lucky ride of I do good stuff, I receive only positivity, and I just keep doing it basically, and it's fun to do.
Right. Backtracking.
Especially since I also learn in the process myself, not just how to play the character, but play against it, and then like also I get to have that character for my own sessions when people are like, all right, so I need to get better against Falcon.
Oh, yeah.
And I can play it now.
And yeah, and that improves you as a coach as well, too.
Because, yeah, yeah, exactly. Yeah,
that's actually a really good way to come around full circle. Backtracking a little bit. I think we talked about it, but I kind of wanted to go ahead and get a clearer word from you. But when it comes to inspiration for your content, your videos, what's the one thing that, you know, I think that you see a need and you fulfill it? Or like, hey, people don't know how to fight X character. I think or they don't know how to, they want to learn the game. And I think I kind of see that when you explained it, right? Like you talked about X character, and X character is really good at teaching you the fundamentals for the beginner space. If you want to learn a little bit more, like you said, right? Link without the bomb, strong fundamentals, you know, zoner character, right? With the bomb, I got to do a separate video. I got to show you how to do that with Link, become a better Link player that way. And then I think I've noticed, like, yeah, you're going through the more intermediate characters of, like, you need to learn how to do spacing properly or do things like having to have the right combo game set up and knowing when to go for those options.
Right.
What inspired you? Was there any specific YouTuber? I mean, like you said, right, you went back to, you saw Germ's Link video.
I think that was the only, like, I don't know if it's even inspirational. I just saw it and it kind of like, oh, I want to do something similar, the Germ video. And then from there, I'm just kind of been doing my own thing. I feel like I don't really watch any other YouTuber to find my own motivation to do my own content. Like, I kind of just do my own thing and that's it. It's almost like, I feel like there's more the opposite of a lot of channels started because I accidentally started. Like, Beefy Smash dudes are doing what they do because of what I started doing back in Brawl in Smash 4. Same thing with the guy who left. What's his name?
Youngtown?
No, he did tech videos as well.
See, I'm
my Smash corner.
Oh yeah, you're right.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And I, like, I was trying to think people who do combo videos and montages and stuff like that, I feel like they all probably like started off by watching one of the first combo videos that ever existed that I accidentally was the one who did. And then it kind of rolled off. I was like motivated by the fact that other people were motivated to do the same thing. And I just kind of kept it going. I always wanted to like bring something new into the scene and bring something new in terms of content creation. Like make it better and better and better so that it never just like stales out and becomes more like just milked, but rather like, all right, so this is because of all of the support and because of all of the things that everyone in the community has found together, this is the final product of the Art of Falcon. Like, this is how it looks now. Like, this is not just because of me sitting at home doing my thing, but this is because of everything, basically.
Right. And when it comes down to, I think, like you said, we talked about how this goes full circle too. Like, when you make content, this also comes back to you in coaching. Me knowing Korean, which I think it's like a lot of people have said, like, it's one of the most successful. I got the hat from him, but one of the most successful coaches out there to make it. What keeps you coaching? You know, I know I've never taken one of your sessions, but I've always heard like, oh, you know, I've taken coaching from Izaw. I like him. One of my personal favorite things about you is when you make your videos, your voice is just a certain way that it's like, wow, you have a really good voice. I wish I had.
Thanks. I don't really make it a certain way. I just speak, honestly.
That's the thing. It's like, I thought your voice was like, maybe he comes down to a slower tone, speaks a little more soft. I was like, no, that's 110% every day of the week.
I did that for Art of Ganon, though. Okay. I kind of made it more rumbly and darker just because I wanted it to like resonate with the dark, Ganon. Yeah. But otherwise, I just speak and that's it. And I try to be very like clear on what I emphasize. And yeah,
I think that's before you go on to coaching, but I think that's probably what makes listening to you coach others will probably be really good, and you talking in your videos because your voice is such a certain way that makes that
ten times
much better. I know I'm throwing compliments to you, but that's just how I see it. You know, so
right. I guess
to your videos.
Right. Yeah. Thank you for that. But so in terms of coaching, I feel like over time, I've done this 4 years now, and since 4 years ago, I have like a total of maybe 4,000 to 5,000 students, unique students that I've done.
And before we go forward, What came just for me? What came first, coaching or was it content creation? I'm assuming it was content creation.
Content creation first. And then I started coaching like after The Art of Ike, honestly.
Okay, I think you put something out, if I'm not mistaken. Like you.
Yeah.
I remember seeing something after the video.
I got really good at it, I put out videos of how it looked and how it was. Mm-hmm. Even back then, it was like, for its time, it was like, whoa, okay, a lot of people hit me up for it. And now I have like a good way of doing it on stream. So the way it works is that I do 6 hours per day on stream live. And you can either take a 20-minute session, which is 2 best-of-5s, or you do an hour, which is anything from 1 to 2 to 3 to 6 best-of-5s, depending on how the first ones goes. And sometimes I like go and I speak to you about like, all right, so you missed this. I need to visualize this interaction for you. I need to explain the neutral here about shield pressure. I need to talk to you about corner pressure and show you what you can do better. And I visualize things because there's more time. But typically how it works is that I start off with Ike and I start on Stadium. And then the student gets to pick a second stage, whatever stage that is, I'm fine with it. And we start off with a 5 best-of-5. And during the stream, I tell him to close the stream so he doesn't hear me live. And I also mute myself during the Discord call. And what I do is that I speak out everything that he is doing, not doing, could be doing better, any habit I can see, anything he does in disadvantage that I'm like, okay, he keeps double jumping here, he keeps kind of challenging out of shield, he keeps going for fastball air dodge, whatever it is, or like, okay, he always buffers aerials in neutral, he's never landing them, or I'm not getting anti-air, there's no full hop anti-airs here. Mm-hmm. And like I just kind of keep rolling and keep going, and there's like a constant talking basically of everything that I'm noticing, and I do that for the first 2 best-of-5s, and so it becomes a very like easy way for me to just constantly repeat what I'm seeing. And so at the end of it, I'm like, all right, so clearly these 10 things or these 5 things or these 3 things were like what I took advantage of because I kept mentioning it and I kept saying it. And then I talked to the student about it and I kind of like either need to visualize it to them because of the level that they're at, or I just need to say it to them and go, all right, keep this in mind now because you're a high to top level player. You just need to notice it and know it. And then once they get good at it and they kind of fix what they needed to fix, then I take it even further from there. Okay, now we can add this at the ledge. You can kind of do this to a dash away. You can land your aerial and then remember that this doesn't work and so on. So, and yeah, I've done anything from like people who picked up the game a week ago who don't even know how to like grab to a throw and teach them how to play, right, or like low-level players who are, yeah, just like casuals or mid-level players who do like O2 at tournaments, or high-level players who are like PR'd fairly well, to top-level players. Like some of them I can't mention anymore, but yeah. Top-level players like Mr. E, Mr. R, Yez, Raven King, a bunch of other players that I just now are helping out because not only have I downloaded them, but I know like these small, small specific things that everything is good, but there's this one little thing that you're not doing. And if you did it, you'd be extra good.
Right.
So I go through a bunch of smaller things like that with them as well. So it's like, it's just, yeah, I just want to say it all just like snowballed into this. I didn't really plan too much for this to happen. I just kind of I'm just here now in this position kind of.
Oh, that's something that I always tell people, like when you're successful that way, you never really see it happening until you're sit in the seat.
Right.
And you come down, you're like, oh, I'm in this chair. Great. I totally forgot I was in this chair. And I think that's kind of like when I see success, I mean, people see coaches, right? And I think that's something that I've always told people, coaches are very important because it's an outside source that is telling you how to play better or helping you fix an area you may be weaker in.
Right.
And I think that's something that some players in my experience have taken for granted. I've always told people like, well, what do you think about a coach? And I just tell everyone, well, there's a reason why they exist, right? They're here to help you. They see something you don't know. And I think about like one of the coaches, I think the 2-3 coaches that have always come to my mind, well, one of them I can't talk about anymore either, but 3 coaches that have always come to my mind, I've always told people it was Korean, and we've seen his success through his prime student, which was Void. Mm. We've seen, I haven't I haven't really, I just started to learn about him through a friend who's told me about him, but Ramses,
right.
You know, I've been told a lot about Ramses and how his coaching style and how his Twitter game is and how he's trying to teach people through his Twitter. And, you know, the same way that you've done it for years, like you said, four years, you know, sitting in the chair, making coaching videos.
Right.
You know,
coaching videos and just coaching in general.
Exactly. And I think, and I tell people, you know, it's Korea and it's Izaw and it's Ramses. And coincidentally, right. I've always told people, if you want to learn a little bit more, you should hit them up. It's not like they're going to tell you no. You know, they might have to. They don't have to tell you like, hey, I got a wait list. Do you mind waiting like a week or so? Maybe try learning this while you're at it.
I have a 3-week waiting list, by the way, to a month. Oh, so if you're looking to actually book one, then get on it now, because it goes faster than you think. Yeah. And each video I put out, there's always someone who's like, oh shit, right, I forgot, let me do this, and then it like kind of snowballs. But I was gonna say, I lost my train of thought, but I was gonna say, so there's never been a single session ever that someone has been like, yeah, I didn't get much of anything from this and I didn't like it, so I would like my money back. Never happened. Plus, if I have someone like a top player or even high level player that I'm like, yeah, honestly, there's not that much you should work on in terms of like technicality. Like, you're doing all of the options. You countered everything really well. You noticed everything really well. Everything that I spoke out, you mentioned to me, so you're aware of it. You adapted really well. So now it's about just either adapting to it faster, or we talk about mentality. Basically, did you notice where I got shook? Did you notice that you kind of held your breath during recovery and made it tighter than it necessarily needed to be? Did you notice how I got scared there, but you never punished me? Did you notice how you got scared every time I did this? And so we talk about basically mentality and how to prepare for tournaments or matchups, or basically there's like no end to it. You can always get better at the game, no matter how good you think you are, because at the end of the day, when you're a top level player in top eight, sitting there playing as somebody eight in top eight, what you're doing is that each interaction, after game, after game, after game, is that what you're doing is that you're learning how to beat someone, and so you're adapting to it. There's never just like, I already know how to win this, and I already know how to play, so I'm gonna just do all of that and win. That doesn't ever work.
It's funny that you say that, because I don't want to throw names out of respect for people, but being a commentator and, you know, having to work several events as I have, I've heard that from some top players before, and you'd be surprised. Like, I just tell people like, why? In the back of my, I'm not judging him for it. You know, but it's like, wow, you really got that process. And then I see them lose, and I'm like, well, I guess because you only saw the victory. You did not see the fight. That's why you lost. I don't want to tell them that.
They played the single player game. Exactly. It doesn't work.
And it's funny how when I've heard it several times, I don't want to say their names. You know, I don't want to throw them under the
bus. Right.
You'd be surprised.
You'd be surprised. Yeah.
But when it comes, speaking of, you know, coaching, we talked about content creation. The final C in this three-parter for me is I lost my train of thought. I said,
don't worry about it.
Commentating. Have you ever taken that? Because somebody with your expertise and your knowledge,
right?
I've always told people, I'm surprised Izaw is not a top commentator. Like, I'm surprised I don't hear him or see him at an analyst desk. I mean, granted, because, you know, Smash is more so community supported rather than, you know, supported by its devs like Street Fighter or any other. At this point, any other fighting game. I'm just surprised. Have you ever thought, and has anybody ever approached you? Because like I said, I'm going to repeat myself here.
Honestly, it hasn't been approached yet. Nobody's asked me to like commentate yet. Although people have been asking me like, you should do it. Like, tournament organizers and stuff are like, you should do it. Mm-hmm. But they've never approached me with, hey, we'll make you do it and we'll pay you this money. Like, no one has actually approached me with the final thing. But they've been like, hey, maybe you should think about it. And I'm like, sure. I've tried commentating for fun on some like locals or whatever, or on stream for like my crew battles or sub tournaments or whatever it is. I'm either very goofy or too into like calling. I'm like reading and downloading what is happening with one opponent and then calling them out as if I'm playing against them, and then like making the adaptation, speaking it out, almost like coaching them unintentionally. Like, oh, he shouldn't do that. He should do this instead. And so it becomes this like, just like I don't know if it's messy, but it's just like a weird commentating style.
Well, but I think that's the one thing I've always told everybody. Like, my first year of commentary was just learning the ropes, like learning my ad libs, my flow, all that stuff. And then the second year was trying to take myself to other locals. And then the third year was like starting to implement myself into other areas. I think when I tell people, when it comes down to commentary, it doesn't matter if you're silly. It doesn't matter if you're that kind of style. I think what matters is that you're able to. Well, there's two types of commentary before I finish up the train of thought. There's two types.
Right.
There's analyst and then there's color, right? Somebody who's doing consistent shoutcasting and somebody who's doing analyzing. And I think about when it comes to those two flows working together in tangent, being silly is a totally great thing, especially if you're being analyst and especially for doing color and especially if you know the other person. I tell people I've had a better time doing commentary with somebody if we are close enough to be like friends. Because you look about it like with TK and EE, right? These two are basically borderline friends. I mean, they're friends. Right. So like,
it's fun listening to them.
Exactly. And because they're friends, because they hang out with each other, they talk to each other all the time, they're able to provide a commentary that it's just, you know, them going back and forth and speaking to each other, just like you and I are right now. So when I tell people about that, like, my advice to you is just definitely do it. Definitely, if you feel like you're silly, if you feel like you're doing, you know, like, oh, it's probably a little weird. Just don't, because that's some of the best part about commentary is when you have that kind of slip up and you just try to catch yourself back, and then maybe the Twitch chat or somebody laughs with you about it.
All right. You know how there's double commentary is great. I feel like the dynamic between one who's very analytical and like speaks a lot and speaks quickly about what's happening, and then the other who's like the funny hype guy who throws in like the rest of the good stuff, that's for me, that's the best double combination. I don't know if I've found that with anyone else. I'd love to try. I would probably not be I can't speak a lot and quickly about what happens, so that would not be me. But I've noticed now there's like a lot of tournaments that do triple commentary. And I would love to do something like that and just be the like third guy.
Shoutcasting is pretty fun when you're like, I've done it with Strides and Z-Fly a couple times, and then we've always noticed like, oh yeah, it is Strides getting to be Strides and me getting to be me, and then we all get to like put that together into a table.
Right. Obviously I'm down to do it. Mm-hmm. It's just no one's really, everyone has like tried to tell me you should, but none of the tournament organizers have actually gone, all right, we'll have you do it if you want to do it, and we'll do this for you if you do it, like the pay is, and like we'll fly out to maybe this, or even if it's something small, like I'm down to do it. I'm down to hear whatever, you know. I'm down, basically.
And then for me, just because like I've told people this, I think, well, 2020, we all had to sit down a little too long, but we all had to sit down. I just tell people in my experience of commentary, sometimes I wish people reached out to me, but it's also me reaching out to them. I think one of the greatest commentators that has ever put that into great context and great beginning to start is CJM. Like, he talked about how like when he first started, like, hey, you know, I was just a scrub, I had to learn the game, I had to learn this, I had to learn that, and then I made a highlight reel, and then I had to start reaching out to people. Sometimes there's money involved, sometimes there's not, you know. You have to learn to do things slowly for free. But I've always told people, like, you know, just to close out our little section on commentary, I've always told people, like, I felt like the reason why people, in my opinion, I don't know, this is 110% sure, I don't want somebody to, like, you know, tweet at me like, hey, the answer totally wrong. No. The reason why I think people enjoyed Korean doing commentary is because you, from my experience, just, I don't want to say you guys are all the same, but seeing Ramses, seeing you, seeing Korean, having students, doing coaching, able to do that, goes back really well into commentary, that when he does it, it is very much not only him being informal to people and informing people of, like, you know, the little things of like, oh, he didn't shield pressure.
What actually happened.
Because he's a coach, because he's, you know, sitting down with a tweak, and I'm sure laughing every once in a while.
Like,
and when I get to see, I've heard Ramses do commentary a few times. When I get to hear him do it, I'm like, wow, that's something. So when I hear your videos, I was like, shoot, he should be doing this. He should be out there. I don't know what he's doing, you know? Like, I want to tell him, but now I'm telling you.
Right. Well, I'm either very busy with making videos, coaching, traveling for my own tournaments, practicing, or just living my life, because there's a lot of moments in my life people are like friends of mine are like, come on, dude, you gotta spend time a little bit more. I like, great that this goes well for you, but like, you gotta give us a little bit of time, a little bit more. And so I need to do that because I love them and I want to spend time with them and I want to enjoy my life, not just sit and like constantly be busy with Smash. So that's partially why I just haven't really gotten into that part, because I've felt too busy already. But I feel like 2021, I'm down to try it. I'm down to do it. I'm down to have people reach out to me, and I'm down to reach out to people for it too.
Right. So, sorry, I gotta adjust myself. My chair is a little weird.
Yeah, don't worry.
My last, probably as we starting to close this out, but my biggest question to you is, what is, and I'm trying to find the right words to this because I already practiced it in my head, but I cannot get it down on my tongue. For the European scene, you know, I think that's the one thing that I've always had an appreciation for a little bit, is I have to tell everybody like, oh, they have DreamHack. Oh, I would be up at like, what would it be? I think 1 or 2 in the morning here, or 3 in the morning. And I remember like being like, oh, there's a European major I have to see, because this is part of their circuit and this is part of that. What does it feel like, you know, to know that you guys have like essentially what, like you guys had a major, you know, the European scene had a major in a soccer stadium.
Right.
Like, and I was just like, here in
the, you mean the France one, right?
Yeah, yeah, the France one. And I'm like, here in the US, we're lucky enough to have a local in someone, and what's going to be now when we come back,
right,
is probably going to be locals in someone's apartment or backyard. Or, right. You know, I mean, and it's not that I don't like, if you guys have come to MSM, I think that's what I tell people. The reason why MSM happens at a ballroom every week is pretty amazing. Because, first of all, to rent out a ballroom space can be pretty expensive. But not only that, it's air controlled, it's quality controlled, there are restrooms, and not only that, there is parking. That's the biggest deal that we have here on the West Coast. Parking is difficult. Living in LA, I've lived and worked in downtown LA, it's difficult as hell.
Right.
That's why I tell people there's no locals in downtown LA, because it's really, nobody wants to pay $20 parking, or what would be $6 parking eventually after like 8 p.m. Nobody wants to pay that. Not only that, I've been to some venues, coincidentally high quality venues, I don't want to say their names, but they're very, very nice people, and I've liked their venues, that don't have really good air conditioning. And that's like the biggest problem. It's like, when you're playing,
that's a big problem.
Yeah, that is a big problem. You're having dudes and people just inside one room for a long time in the summer, and what's going on here in SoCal. So like,
right.
But how does it feel to have all that, you know, the European scene?
Right.
What do you like about it? What don't you like about it? Because that's what I've always been interested in, is like, we see a lot of the positives. Are there any negatives? And what's your feedback to it? Because my opinion was, I saw the PGR, and like everybody's who saw it from the European scene, I said Europe was snubbed. That's totally not fair. Like, they had some really big majors, and that was not included in the PGR. And I'm not I'm not saying like the PGR is trash. No, that was my criticism of it. Like, we need to not only just include Japan, but there's a lot of great European players. And I know that we're only seeing Gluttony and Quick and Space, but there are a few players that we don't get to see. Like you said, you're one of the few who consistently travel to the US.
Right?
And I've seen you. I think we met each other at Hyrule Saga, and I remember the best moment. I tell everybody the best moment I ever had with Izaw, meeting him for the first time, was you walked around, I don't know what happened, you walked around the venue and you had your shirt off, and then Cesar was following you, and he's like, what is he doing? He's like, he's working on his tan, man. I don't know.
Yeah, I'm just trying to tan, dude.
And Cesar was like, just trying to tell you, like, yo, we gotta put your shirt back on, man. but yeah, what is it like to be part of the European scene, and what are your criticisms of it, I guess? That's what I'm curious. For everybody out there.
I don't really have anything too bad to say about the European tournament scene. I feel like there's a lack of locals, like a big lack of locals. And there's just only a few tournaments that are big. I feel like we can do more. And I feel like we also could do more only if we got more Americans to fly out, because like, only Europe doing big tournaments consistently is not going to be something that I think financially will work as much as it does in the US.
Right.
So it's partially also like, it would really, really help us if Americans just choose to fly out more instead of just stick to being in the US. But yeah, like American locals are great because they're consistent. They're always at a good time. They're not just early all the time and then end early as well, which, I mean, nobody wants to play Smash super early in the morning all the time. at least not me. I can't do that. But yeah, tournaments in general. Yeah, mm-hmm. European tournaments in general are pretty good, honestly. I feel like I would just like it. I would like there to be more. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I feel like that's what it is to me sometimes. Like finding a VOD, if I'm finding VODs, I'm usually finding of like of a major or a regional. Usually it's
right.
Rarely, but I see a VOD for a local. Sometimes right. I feel like majors or regionals. And I think that's why I appreciate those VODs so much. It's like, oh, wow, I get to see X player do, you know, a matchup I've never seen. I
guess, yeah.
You know, so that's what I tell people, I think.
I feel like MSM was great. And just like all the locals in LA were really, really, really good. And it was just hype in general to go there. And it was just consistent and good time and everything.
Yeah, I think that's the one thing that SoCal, I think now that we're going to come, hopefully, fingers crossed, right? We come back as early as possible. But like, that's what I think the one thing I tell people is like, the problem for us was we had one too many locals. Like
right.
there was no sanctioning. There was, and seeding was always a big contention of like, oh, this player isn't seeded. Well, like, I'm sorry, I didn't seed X person from, you know, from that. Cause you know, there's so many locals right. every day, and some locals don't want to be part of the sanctioning of it. Right. Cause like I used to tell people, the biggest problem sometimes that we had was there was a player farming a local and everybody goes, well, let me backtrack.
It wasn't Zenyu.
No. Well, it's funny. I love Zenyu. I love him right. so much. He Fire and Dice was his paycheck, basically.
Yeah.
Like, he'd go to Fire and Dice, he'd win it. And then Nico started winning it. And then there was this funny yeah. tension of like, Shulk sucks. I hate this.
Right.
I'm not going to say the point, but like,
that's okay. So actually, now I just want to say real quick because you reminded me. Mm-hmm. I feel like that's probably the biggest thing that I miss about Europe, or that is missing in Europe, are these like, just like these battles for against people, these stories, like the rivalries, because there's not so much going on. It's just everyone's nice and friendly and hanging out, and then if there is any tension, even if it's playful, it's only like a European versus the American who barely shows up, and so it becomes kind of like
yeah. Some of my favorite matches are always like, I think
Leffen versus Salem.
those are the best ones. When I think about it, it's also like Europe versus the U.S. I think there was a really good Smash 4. I can't remember, and it's escaping me really badly, but there was a very good Smash 4 tournament. I won where like a couple U.S. players showed up, and all like you can hear the chants all from Europe. I think it might have been Beast or Avalon, one of them. I think like West Ball showed up to one of those.
Oh, yeah, I know what you're, I think that was Beast, actually.
Yeah, and Rich Brown showed up. Yeah. And then when they were getting, like, top eight, you could, like, the European chants were, like...
I think ESAM and MBD showed up for that.
Yeah, and I was like, wow, these chants from... I mean, I'm granted, I want my American brethren to win, but, like, these... I'm really having fun listening to Europe want to get this W. And that creates this whole, like, dude, I want more European tournaments because these seem so hype. They're not either in a really, like the France one, they're in a soccer stadium or they're in a really cool church.
It's mostly because the Americans tend to just undervalue the European players and how good they are and how many they actually are because they don't show themselves as much, like, which, like, it makes sense that Europe, not as good, but if you'd come here, you'd probably think otherwise.
Right. That's what I tell people. Like you don't see. I think that's the one thing I've always appreciated about seeing players like Quick and Gluttony try to make that. You know, they came here for a Congo Saga, and like that's why people see like when they think about European players, I think they only think of like you know Quick and Gluttony because they're the two most prominent who've come to the US. And that's what I tell people. I think now, in which I'm going, like, geez, I'm just spilling the beans at this point. If the episode hasn't happened, it'll happen. But I'm going to talk to Sonics because he's from the Dominican Republic. He's number one in the Dominican Republic. The only reason why he's getting hate is because he mains Sonic. And, you know, Sonic on Wi-Fi is one of the most terrible things you can experience. But that's why I tell people there are all these players from all these worlds. And just because you don't see them getting top eight doesn't mean they're not good. You know, and... But yeah, to go back, I think that's what I want to see more from Europe is, like you said, those stories. Like, I tell people the funniest thing about sanctioning tournaments, to come back to that really quick, was for a time, I'm going to say his name because he's one of the players who's become this tour de force with this character was, for a time, mm-hmm. Master Mario was looked at as a meme. Nobody appreciated Master Mario. Mm-hmm. Master Mario was this guy who farmed one local or two locals in Long Beach, right. and that was it. And nobody, people shrugged him off to the side. No one cared. He's just a scrubby Mario main, just like Charlie. And then one day he came to a tournament, and then everybody said, well, damn. He beats Zenyu. He's sitting on top 8. And that started to create this thing of, like, Master Mario has to be respected now. Because he is this threat that's actually really, really good. And then when he beat Dark Wizzy, it was like, oh, shoot, Master Mario is, you know, a top-level Mario. Because, you know, so-and-so-and-so.
But yeah, it has to do with a lot of mentality, honestly. And it's the same thing for European players. When they fly out to the U.S., there's this, like, enormous pressure from, like, I paid a lot more than usual to fly out here. I'm playing a lot more than usual to, like, live and eat here. There's expectation that's riding on my shoulders. There's so much more tension than usual. People are looking down on me already. I'm already the underdog. And it's just, like, there's such a mentality that you have to adapt to that the Europeans are sometimes not ready for. But it would be a lot easier for them to perform at home, obviously, like in Europe, than in America, because of all of these factors. But I feel like over time, the more the Europeans start traveling, because there's a lack of Europeans traveling, honestly. But the more they do it, and the more that do it, I feel like that's going to go away, and it's just going to be seen as, it's just a tournament. It's not, oh, this big American tournament that we have to kind of do our best at, and it's once like I only got one shot, and then that's already like a bunch of pressure you put on yourself for no reason.
Mm-hmm. I think that's just very true. I think it'd be easier if I think that's the one thing about Soka that I appreciate it, which I take part of, is like when we travel in packs. You know, it's either me taking a carpool, Larry taking a carpool, you know, we're moving all together as a force, so that when we do play, we're all backing each other up, you know. And like, you're right, I think the one thing that I've always appreciated about the European scene is its esports scene as a whole seems to be much more, generous wouldn't be the right word, but it's more upfront from what I've seen. Like, you guys have DreamHack, which is one of the tournaments that I've told people, like, wow, when I found out that DreamHack had its own circuit with Smash, like, a little while back, I was amazed. I was like, wow, we don't even have that. You know, we're having to make our own circuit through, you know, Esports Arena and 2GG teaming up together to do something like that. But that's one thing that I've always appreciated about the European scene is I think the sponsorships seem to be a lot more, what's the word? I guess serious would be the take. I don't know if I'm going in the right path here.
Maybe. I'm not too involved in that, or I'm not too educated on it, but I guess what you're looking for is, like, it's like more well prepared and well established, because I think it's mostly because of the few amount of tournaments that we have that we invest so much into that one big one rather than like many big ones.
Right.
That it becomes just like a cleaner, bigger tournament kind of.
Yeah. And then that's what I have to say. I think we pretty much have a show. We have it all pretty wrapped up. I guess probably I think that's the one thing that everyone's having a thought process on that I guess I want to ask everybody in this first season of me doing this podcast is, like, what are your thoughts, to close things out, what are your thoughts on the state of Smash pre-COVID and after what I have to call the great calamity that just happened a little while
ago? Right.
Like, what are your thoughts? I mean, I could say mine, but mine are important. I think what I want to hear is yours. Being a content creator, being a coach, how has that affected you, but also what are your thoughts on it as a whole?
Honestly, if you ask me, I don't know what's going on because it kind of like clashes, because my YouTube and most other YouTubers, it's going down, not just in content creation and views and hype and all that kind of stuff. Like, Smash is slowly, Ultimate is slowly kind of like going downwards. And it's sure there's like spikes, it goes up when there's new DLC. But then it kind of slowly goes downwards again. And now specifically because we don't really have consistent tournaments and the hype is dying and there's a lot of big streamers that have died now and there's not like all the big events. It's kind of at its worst. I would say, like, even Smash 4 at its worst was better than this at the moment that we have with Ultimate. But I think it'll go back up. Pretty sure it'll go back up. It just, I feel like rather than thinking about, I feel like there should be a lot of more people who focus on thinking about the future of how we can make everything better and more consistent and bring the hype back up and bring all these events that people want to see so that we actually have like something that goes upwards instead of just kind of sinking down with everything that's going on.
You're right.
If you ask me, it's weird at the same time because I'm getting more and more and more people asking me for coaching than ever now, which is strange. I feel like it doesn't really make sense. So there's a good part of it too. There's a lot of players out there more than ever that are trying to get into the tournament scene and will get into the tournament scene 2021 that have never been to tournaments, but now because of the consistent sessions they take with me or just like one session, whatever, they will go to tournaments now and they will try to make a name for themselves or...
They start to build up that fire in them.
So I feel like it's looking really bad now, but I don't feel like it's going to just go downwards only. Mm. It's going to come back up probably as soon as we have a vaccine, at least.
Which I feel like is just like every day.
Or a super hype DLC or something.
I think it was funny too. Min Min came out and that was met with more praise than like the previous DLCs.
Right.
I think people didn't really like the deal. I think the only DLC everybody liked was like maybe Banjo and Joker, and that's it. If I'm being honest, like I felt like Terry is pretty cool, but people complain about Terry. Like, oh, he has auto turnaround, so I hate this character.
Right. The problem with the Min Min DLC is that we don't get to see it in tournaments. We don't get to see the top players use it, and we don't get to see like the optimized version of it. So there's no like additional hype to it. So people are just assuming. It's either a toxic character or just like a non-viable character or a broken character, and it just kind of gets put into the corner of like this is what it is, and then the hype dies because there's nothing that builds the character up.
Yeah, I felt that's what kind of happened to Byleth. Like people are like, oh, Byleth sucks. I was like, I don't think this character is bad.
I love Byleth.
I'm with you. I love this character, but I don't think the reason why we're not seeing this character so much is because, you know, Byleth came out literally like a week or two before the quarantine started happening, so she didn't have a chance to show up, only with MKLeo with one tournament with one game, and then we never really saw the character much.
I think Byleth just got hate because it's a Fire Emblem character and it was just like, oh, it's a wasted slot. But you have to remember, I don't know if you remember the Ultimate trailer when it first came out and the announcement, there was this moment where Sakurai looked into the camera and he said, I'm sorry if you're expecting a bunch of DLC for this game, but there's not going to be that many added characters. And so far, we're getting more and more and more and more and more and more and more. he debated us really heavily.
Yeah.
He wanted to be like, guys, please stay humble. But people are just like, oh, dude. So, and then we get six extra characters and it's just overlooked because Byleth is a Fire Emblem character and boo. But like, It wouldn't be as much of that mentality if it was cool to watch this character consistently, you know, do well in tournaments and events in general, because then it would be hype to see all of these amazing plays and whatever the character can do.
Yeah, I think when I think about characters, I always tell people a character has potential. Every character has potential to be a character you will see in the tournament.
Well, there are some except Little Mac.
Yeah, except Little Mac. And even then, I'd be surprised in SoCal. We'll see like a couple players do really, really well or get an upset. But I think when it comes down to some characters, I tell people characters have potential. The hype of the character is all depending on the player that brings that character to the limelight, that brings that character to a top 8 of a tournament or a top 8 of a major.
Mm.
More so less a major than a tournament because, you know, people can see a lot of characters in tournaments all the time, but where it really matters is top 8 of a major or top 8 of a regional, and then that starts to turn heads like, wow, this character, oh, this player is doing hype things. Like Nico with Choke. I used to always tell people in Smash 4, Nico was a player without a top character. By design on paper, Choke sounded broken in Smash
4. Right, but inhumanely broken. And like, or execution-wise, you need to be inhumane for it to have, like, work.
Yeah. And then yeah. Nico did what he could with the character, and now we're coming to Ultimate, and now everyone's like, dude, Shulk is the most broken thing in this game. And I'm like, well, yeah. You know, I told you guys last game it was pretty tough, and now you guys are just complaining. But to come finally to close this for us, I've had such a great time talking to you and hearing your thought process. the final question, I guess, because I kind of already asked it, but I just wanted to clear it out.
Go for it.
When everything happened with how it happened on Twitter, and these things are coming out to light, because that's the question I'm going to have to ask everybody, because I feel like that's the one thing a lot of people want to know.
Right.
And as at time of this recording, I'm going to have somebody who will be on the show, and she will share maybe her thoughts if she's open to it. I kind of want to respect her space too as well. How did you take it? How did you deal with it, and how did you see it? Because on my end, on my front, I saw it as, here's X and X and X person, or maybe there's probably like two people that inspired me to become a part of the scene.
Right.
And then knowing that they have been this type of person kind of like hurt me, but also made me realize, like, you know what? Well, I've already realized it years before, but like, I'm part of the scene because I enjoy this, but also there are these group of people that now become my friends who, thank God, they're great people.
Right.
But when all this stuff happened, I took it as like, wow, the very thing that inspired me is the very thing that is wrong now.
Yeah.
So how did
you? I took it pretty harshly, honestly. I didn't want to speak about it because I have a hard time expressing how I feel sometimes. Mm-hmm.
And if you don't, it's fine. You know, don't worry.
Yeah. No, it's fine. I got disappointed at a bunch of things, but I honestly think it stems from not just like a human lack of working on themselves to be a good person. It was just overlooked completely, but it was a lack of gratefulness for what they already had. I feel like people who are grateful, or anyone who's grateful for what they have, their fans, they're like, oh, I have so much, like, I'm lucky to have met Sakura. I'm lucky to be a part of making all these accomplishments in Smash. I'm lucky to bring the community upwards and inspire people and influence people. Having gratefulness for that in general would not make you do any of those things, because you would start thinking about things like, if I had a kid and I wanted him to look up to me, which eventually I'm going to have one, and he's going to see everything that I'm currently doing, and all these other people and parents and sponsors that also have kids, and like, you would start thinking about these things, and you would try to do your best in doing your best rather than just like, you know, oh, I have all of these stuff now, and I can just kind of like take advantage of things without people noticing, and just kind of like not work on yourself as a person. It is just something that's overlooked by a lot of Smashers, honestly. But yeah, it really disappointed me, because not only does it like ruin a lot of the progress that we've made.
Right. I feel like you said earlier, right? It sets us back. Like, now
it does.
It sounds like I'm being biased towards them, or I don't like them. And I want to say for the record, it's not that. It's none of that.
Right.
It's none of that at all. This is what I see. And sometimes I'm a little more hurt that way because it's what I see. And I think there's a few players that make their decision to show the better side of that community. That's that community. But for what I see always on Twitter, it's always this. Now that Melee has rollback netcode and all this and all that, now sometimes what I see on Twitter is, oh, Melee is back. Screw Ultimate. You guys don't need Ultimate. We're Melee. And it's like, wow, that really hurts, guys. Like, geez, we never really fought you guys, but now it feels like I'm being told Melee is a superior game, and Ultimate was bad from the beginning because you guys all talked bad about Ultimate.
Right.
And Ultimate sucks, and play Melee. And it's like, okay, but like, we never talked bad about Melee, so why are you talking bad about us? Just how I've seen it, and now that Ultimate is going down, even on the Twitch views, like, I see it. Like, Melee has way more viewers sometimes than Ultimate. Like I said, this is...
Right, it'll go down, though. Like, there's obviously, like, hype spikes, and then it goes down again. But I'm not gonna lie, Melee is the better online game.
Oh, definitely.
By far.
By far, yes.
And I feel like we need Melee as well. I don't know why it's two separate games rather than one big thing, honestly. I love Melee as much as I like Ultimate. I just don't like playing Melee because it messes up my hands and it's just not a game for me. But I love watching it, and I love watching it sometimes more than Ultimate. Depends on who it is and what who's playing and the level of it. But yeah, I understand where Melee people are coming from and where Ultimate player are coming from when it comes to the online aspect. But to me, I was one of the first people to create accidentally a community of people to watch Smash and join Smash and play Smash, because before Smash Boards was even a thing, before All This Brawl, before Discord or anything like that, I put out a YouTube channel with, oh, we can finally record things and put it on the computer, and then people like gathered and started like joining the community, and then that inspired other people to do it. But it's just sad to see that some just did it wrong completely and messed up so much that it sucked for me, and it messed up my head for a couple of days. It really did.
Yeah. I kind of took it as, I'm not getting emotional. I took it as, cause I've already told myself, like I came to this community a broken person. For those of you guys who don't know me, I came to this community a broken person. I went through a very difficult time in my life where I questioned, like many people, I questioned my own, not humanity, but my own self. Like I never seen myself.
Which is good.
Yeah. And I'm glad I went through it. But like I never saw myself lower than what I was until that point. And then I came to this community, and then it was very welcoming to me. It was very like, I met friends. I met people. I traveled not necessarily the world, but I traveled. And slowly these things that had me broken became repaired to the point that I didn't even notice. And then I said to myself at one point, yes, ex-commentator, because I don't want to say names, inspired me to want to take up the mic. But now I am here because I like being on the mic, but also I want to create that same space that I didn't have to others. And I want to make sure people are okay. So when this all happened, I spoke to a friend, you know, when this happened, he spoke to me. I feel like I failed, you know, with all this happening. I feel like I failed. Like, there is a big loss of trust, I think is what it is.
Yeah.
A big loss of trust. And that's what kind of sets us back. I think somebody who's been very much an esports enthusiast, if my hat doesn't say it, then I don't know what does, who's been an esports enthusiast as the next person, this sets us back by a large margin of, now maybe sponsors are going to be very hesitant. I think.
Not maybe. They are.
Yeah, they are. They are. Exactly.
Yeah.
They are. Like I said, I want to be respectful and I don't want to mention names and to other people because I don't want to trigger anybody. But like, people have said when X player leaves an esports team, oh, this person, this sponsor is going to pick them up, blah, 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 blah. Look at C9. I don't think C9 has picked up anybody in Ultimate. And I think they're very hesitant. And I don't blame them, right? I think this sets us back. And even with some other tournaments too as well. Maybe some, you know, Red Bull may not be more or, you know, just naming a few. I don't know. I'm not involved in those.
I think C9 specifically is not. I don't think they think about it that way, because I know they do Dota. And Dota has the same problem as Smash in terms of what's happened. But yeah, it's not just the sponsors. That's the problem. It's that I personally don't want to send out my own kid, if I had one, to anything like this, you know, like it. And I would previously, but now I feel like there's a lot more work that needs to be done, not just within tournaments and security and all that kind of stuff, but people need to work on themselves. Because from what I've seen, some people who play Smash play to escape, and they escape it so much that they forget to live their own actual life and get better at things in life and get better as a person and all that kind of stuff. So they start not seeing all the bad stuff that they do. And so for all these things by these players were overlooked and not a big deal for them, I guess. So, judging from the apologies, And it's partially because of what I said before, like gratefulness was never truly there. Like working on yourself as a person was never truly there.
I think you worded it so good that I kind of like want to end on that. But right. I also want to end like on a much more lighter note. But yeah, I agree. I think I should, like, for everybody who knows me and like my friends from SoCal and my friends like Errol, Nigel, and we've always, in K-Swiz and Zan and all these other people from my region, like we've always been a group of people that kind of like checks one another, so to speak. I think you, like earlier on the show, you said like sometimes my friends hit me up and like, yo, you gotta, right. You gotta get out, bro. Like you can't just be in the room all day. And that's the same with the way that Arrow hits me up. Arrow tells me like, bro, we gotta go hiking. We gotta go watch a movie.
Hell yeah.
We gotta have movie night. We gotta go hiking. We gotta go IKEA. We gotta be friends, dude. Like we gotta escape our escape.
Right. Like, we gotta enjoy.
You gotta enjoy life. And yeah, Arrow has always been the initiator of that. And it's so much that it's become towards me as well. Like, oh, I tell my friends, like, we gotta go hiking. We gotta do this. And I agree. I think people get so lost in the escape in reality that escape is their own reality that they just treat it so wrong that they forget. Like you said.
Right.
Like you said.
They forget gratefulness is even a part of life to begin with.
Yeah.
And then they fill their own needs and don't grow up as people, which sucks because you're an influencer. And as much as people shouldn't idolize influencers, they should be able to admire influencers, but the influencers need to first take the first step of, I am admired because of these things and I'm grateful for it. And I will try to do better and I'll try to inspire and be the person that I would admire.
Right.
And do the things that I would admire too.
Right. I think Leffen had the best message for everybody. Like, hold people accountable. I think a lot of people saw this as like, oh, you know, this person is this high level. They can never do so wrong. And Leffen was like, no, you have to hold me accountable.
Right.
I'm just a human being, bro. I just put on my pants like everybody else.
Right.
And if you guys are seeing me as this, like, well, in the game, he is a god. But if you see me as this god of a person, you'll never hold me accountable and people will be allowed to escape.
Right. You'll idolize blindly.
You'll idolize them blindly. Exactly. And I think that's a very, very wrong thing.
You should, instead of trying to idolize someone, you should work on being the best person you can be so that you idolize others. Or so that other people doesn't want to, so that you would become the admiration that other, like,
other
so,
people
how do
out.
I put this? Yeah, no, so that you can make other people find admiration for you. Mm-hmm. Like, you want to be that person.
Exactly.
And I feel like idolizing someone is just like, oh, wow, they're this and that, and I'm crazy about it. And it kind of gets stuck there. But admiring someone, like the difference, admiring someone means that you get motivated and inspired and try to do the same or better, like your own version of it.
Right. I think that's where I've come as a person, not only just like in my commentary, but as myself. Like, I've always tried to tell people, like, I think, like I said, I came here a broken person. Now I want to be a better person. I've become a better person so that if I see someone else was the same person that I was when I walked in, I can do my best to provide them that space of like, hey, I'm not alone. Hey, there's this cool community. Hey, there's this and this and that. But also, like, when it comes down to a lot of things, you know, being better helps a lot. And also, like
you
said, going out is healthy. Go watch a movie with your friends. Go get, I mean, we can't do that right now, but like, have a movie night with your friends or have like a drinking space with your friends and things like that. Is there anything you would like to say, you know, before we close out, as a, you know, to your friends, to anything?
I just want to say, honestly, like a bunch of things, but I'll keep it short. So first of all, I want to say thank you to everyone who's been watching me, no matter if it's like from the Brawl days or Smash 4 days or just recently. I appreciate you for watching. I appreciate you for telling other people, if you do, to watch my stuff, because it helps me a lot and it motivates me to keep doing what I'm doing. I also want to thank you for having me on something like this.
No, thank you for coming.
No problem. Today's my day off, so I was like, might as well do something like this. But yeah, and I also want to say it's going to go up 100%. I'm 100% that it's going to go up. There's going to be new top players, people you've never heard of before. There's going to be even better events. There's going to be even better communities made on Twitch. There's going to be even better events made on Twitch. And it's a good thing that we've gone through this so that we can get the toxicity out of the way, make it very clear what is good and bad and how to fix it, not just community-wise, but personally how to fix the issue. For anyone out there who's asking me, hey, can you do the art of X character? Yes, I'll get to it. I'll get to it. I'm trying to make all the characters, but just asking for it never helps. What really helps is that you try to support me on Patreon. And as cheesy as that sounds, it really does. Because YouTube, honestly, when it comes to content like this, like imagine I made an art of Olimar. It's not going to get many views and it's a lot of work. Yeah. And like, if you really want it, you need to help me help you. So I appreciate you asking because it's a constant. It'll be there eventually, and if you want to influence it, then there's a way to influence it.
Yeah, and it has, like, I'm sure like every Patreon does, like, it has its benefits. You know, being a Patreon subscriber helps out people a lot. I think, like, one of my favorite podcasts is done through, like, the only reason why it's alive, even said it, is Patreon. Like, the YouTube algorithm is very, very, people have made videos about it. Like, it's very, very rough. You know, it's either one day it'll pay you great, you're like, hey man, I mean,
especially for games that go downwards.
Oh yeah, most definitely.
Until like Smash 6 comes out, and then it'll go upwards, but it'll go downwards again.
Right. That's what I tell people. Even I support some of my favorite artists. Even if I'm like, I have one artist that I specifically support, even though I don't go on his artist page.
Right.
I was just like, dude, I love his art, and I see it on Instagram. I'm just gonna toss him $5 on Patreon, even if I'm never looking at the benefits. I don't care. I'm happy that this artist puts great art that I enjoy, that I'm willing to, you know, support him. Just the same way that I hope people will do that to support you. Like how I did. Like tell people, if I wasn't confident doing commentary in Smash 4 until I saw Art of Ike, and I'm like, great, now I can probably do this.
Right. I was gonna say that too. Like, obviously some people can support on Patreon, and that's fully understandable. What you can do then is just share the content around and tell people about it, and that helps equally as much. I also want to say I stream literally every day, except sometimes on Wednesday and Saturday I take a break. And I stream anything from like 6 to 8 hours, and what I typically do is I do sessions, and sure, it can be sometimes boring to watch sessions, but if you want to get better, you should watch it, because what I do is that I speak out my downloads. I speak out my adaptation. I speak out why. I visualize why. I show you neutral interactions, corner pressure, and I speak out how I'm winning, because so far I haven't lost, but so far I'm speaking out how I'm winning or losing and why. And so like I feel like each session you'd watch, even though it's something that, oh, this is the same issue as the last person, you learn from it.
Right.
So if you want to get better, you can also just come out and hang out on Twitch, because I have a sweetheart of a community as well, and it's just fun to hang out.
If you don't want to do the whole, like, I need to have a Patreon, because that's the one thing I tell people, I don't like, the Patreon app feels weird. Like, layout of the app, I'm not a big fan of. If I just throw in a sub, I just like, hey, here's the app. Here's my $5 a month, though. I'm happy to support you.
I mean, shit, you don't even need to sub. Just come hang out if you want to.
So you've already said, my question, because this is season one, I promise you guys, season two will be different. If I can get you back on season two, you know.
Am I episode one, by the way?
I will tell people this, and I'll tell you this. Okay. Because of scheduling, I'm going to, this is my confession. I expected a lot of no's.
Okay.
I expected a lot of no's. Shout outs to Arrow. He kind of like, I think you've met him before. He literally grabbed me, like the way he explained things, the way I can traumatize. He grabbed me by my shirt and he slapped me in the face and he says, you have been holding yourself back far too long. This is what you're doing wrong. And I'm going to tell you this even though you don't want to hear it. And I looked at it and I was like, you're right. It hurts to hear this, but you're right. So I said, I will come back, do this, and put out season one of this new thing that I'm doing for the third time. And I'll do it. And I'm going to do it the best I can to a quality and a standard that I hope I can meet with people. Mm-hmm. So yeah, he told me, like, this is who I feel like you should reach out to. This is
He told me about me. Let's go.
we've talked about, like, I want to make sure I tell people, like, yeah, he's told me about a lot of people. Yeah.
Nice.
Arrow's been a really great friend of mine for the past.
That's cool. Yeah.
3 years, I want to say, like 3 years, because we've been traveling. So yeah, this. But also JMX has also been somebody who's also, like, helped me out and, like, has told me, like, this is what you gotta do. It's not as hard as, like, JMX has always been the person that can come up to something of a problem and he'll be like, dude, it's not that hard. It's this and this and that.
Right.
It's not that hard. And I'll be like, right. Oh, you're right. Thank you. So this is season one. If there's a huge outcry, you know, I hope your fans enjoy this. I really do. And if your fans come, if you want to send your fans to me as a positive way, like, hey,
get me on. Yeah, I mean, I feel like you should keep doing this. This is good. Yeah. This is fun.
Get me on for season two. I think the one thing I want to do is I don't want to send, I'm the opposite. I hope I'm not influencing your fans in the wrong way. But, like, yes, support is on Patreon. But for me, I want to make sure I do this the right
way.
Go
for it.
I do want to take in fan questions. That's for sure. I do want to take in fan questions. But I want to make sure people only have to go in one direction. So I'm hoping to do this live on the 2G Gaming official Twitch and have, like, a sub-only chat. And if you want to chat there in the sub-only chat, you know, we can ask your questions. But my question to you, I'll pretend I am the chat. My question to you is, do you ever plan of doing an Art of Smash for Melee? Has that ever been approached? Has anybody ever approached you for it? And do you ever plan to do it? Because that's the one thing I think we talked about this pre-show. I don't know. Maybe I might be repeating myself, and I apologize. That's the one thing I told you about. Like, that's my favorite thing about the newer Smash games is you can learn, like, that through content creators than Melee. Granted, Melee has dozens of VODs and top players, but there is no one central, you know, YouTuber or person making one video where I can go the art of Melee Marth, and they will go through the 30-minute primer of, like, this is, you know, what you've done, basically. I don't want to repeat the whole thing.
I've thought about it, and I've also hit up Armada about it, and he wants to do it. We're both very busy, though, but I'm definitely thinking about it, and I very well might do it. That's the thing. Like, I can't guarantee it, but, yeah, I'm definitely thinking about it.
If just me hearing you say
Armada, I'm heavily considering it.
Okay, that's cool. That's cool. Yeah. That's the
way. And me and Armada are close, so, like, it would be very good, and it would be very, like, it's easy to approach the project. I personally don't know where to take it, but I'm sure I'll find my way around it, especially because Armada is also a good teacher and a good coach, and, like, he knows his stuff. So, I'm sure that eventually I might get around to it.
Right.
Okay. Yeah.
So it's in the cards. Izaw, where can people find you? You talked about your YouTube. Where can they find you? Tell me your Twitter, your Twitch, your YouTube.
They can find me on YouTube on Izaw Smash, Twitter on Izaw Smash, Twitch on Izaw Smash. You can find me. Where else could you find me? On Discord. My Discord link for my server is almost everywhere. So if you go to my YouTube channel and you just click on the description, you'll find my Discord server. So you can find me there if you want to personally, like, hit me up for a session or just, join the Izaw Smash server and hang out. There's also a student Discord that you can join once you either sub to my Twitch or you become, like, you take a session, you become a student, and you can join the exclusive Izaw Smash student server. And in there, it's an actual community rather than just, like, a bunch of fans in one place. It's a community of people, and there are, I would say it's probably the best online service you'll find, because we have friendlies matchmaking system online, or ranked matchmaking system, weeklies, prizes for those weeklies, monthlies, and you get feedback from me and other people. There's a bunch of top players in there. There's a bunch of high level, mid level, low level. You'll find anything very easily. And people are really helpful there. So if you're looking for a place to not go to Quick Play and get cheesed and actually find an online way to get better, this is probably the best from what I've heard from every single one who's in the Discord, they said this is the best place to get better because of like the system that we have.
Yeah. And I'm glad to hear that, because I know there was Smash Ladder, and then what was it called? Smash Ladder.
Right.
And then everybody told me like it's so dead. It's like no
one. It's dead.
Yeah, it's dead.
So it's like, dead.
So you definitely putting out the word for that server.
It's because it became toxic, and it doesn't matter like how many good players you'll find there. If it's toxic and you can't speak to the other person and get feedback from the other person and just get trashed verbally, then you're just gonna get demotivated. But there's no such thing. There's no such thing on my server. People help each other no matter what.
Yeah.
And if they can't, you tag me and I help.
Is all.
So, yeah.
Thank you for your time.
No problem, dude. Thank you for having me.
It's been a tremendous. I've had an enjoying moment of my life right now talking to you. It's been great. One of the persons that I've been like influenced by a lot, like I just but like I watching his vlogs was like, it was not right. only a treat, but was also like an informative experience. It was like going to a school I like.
Right.
Granted, I am going to.
Oh.
And I know I'm probably like
for free, by the way.
Yeah, for free, for free. Which I'm telling everybody. But thank you so much for being a part of the show, guys. If you want to watch the show, obviously you probably already see the VOD here. God, I'm already losing the words here. YouTube.com/2GGaming. Yes, I will put this on Spotify. I am working on that.
Oh, nice.
I also hope to put this on live on Twitch for you guys to watch. And if you guys want to talk, we'll have a subscriber only chat. If you have any questions you guys want to ask me, please feel free to DM me. My DMs are always open. @Vance_EXE. Yes, there are more episodes. Of course, if you guys want to keep up with the episodes, you guys can follow me or follow the 2G Gaming Twitter. We'll go through a process of retweets and stuff like that. Is this the first episode? Well, that is a good question, because I want to make sure I have everything right. Like I said, I got a lot of no's. I thought I was going to get a lot of no's, but
right.
A lot of people are more humble than I thought, and you're very humble.
Right.
And like, so we'll see. I think this is going to be a great episode, phenomenally, as you guys have already heard. But without further ado, guys, this is an episode, and I'm glad you guys have come a part of it, Izaw. Once again, thank you for being a part of it.
Thank you.
Until next time, it has been my pleasure to serve you.